I'm going to challenge you all to think about something, what you all what you said, but apply this question. So we're all here today with the idea that, okay, so we have this institution here that does a lot of things for a lot of different things for a lot of different people. How is it, if we were to agree that you're right, we should do what you're doing, how is it that you go about doing that in a large, essentially decentralized, sorry, Mr. President, institution with lots of competing interests and lots of self-interests? How do you do it? Do you just evangelize and hope that some people take it up, hope that some of them are successful, hope that someone else copies it or does something like it? Or do you try to do something from the top down? Do you, if you're a department chairman, do you say, everyone in my department, for one of their courses, must change it in a way that's like one of these things? Just try it. Is that what you do? Do you give bonuses to people who do that? Or take money away from people who don't? How do you do this on an institution-wide basis?
I can begin. There are all of the above is true. Everybody's trying all of those approaches, but there are also other ways to do it. And and in my opinion, the successes that we have had at Virginia Tech have been because we had bottom-up imagination, creativity, inventiveness, and buy-in and buy-out. And we also had leadership that said, we are going to move in a particular direction. So, for example, we have a very large faculty development institute and a large graduate education development institute that is aimed at helping people imagine what they need to do in their own teaching space. It's very much a bottom-up exercise. You can come anytime you want to, but at the very least, you get to come once every 4 years because that's when you get your new equipment and software. And if you want the equipment and software, you need to come. So it's a good way to get people to come and do something with you. It's not enough, though. As my good friend Gardner Campbell is wont to say, and he heads up the Faculty Development Institute right now for Virginia Tech, training and workshops is not enough. People need to be involved, as you've heard everybody say here, in actually doing some things, getting dirt under their fingernails, working on a larger project. So, for example, the course redesign effort that Carol Twigg led for many years allows people to say, I am going to look at large-scale introductory courses because that's where the majority of our students are, and we heard yesterday comments about that those might be commodity courses anyway. Some of us know that we're not serving that particular group of students very well, so you could, as a leadership in an institution, say, I invite you to propose things that you would do in this arena and give the courageous few who want to do it. It can be courageous many because it is infectious, a grant to do that. And it's not a $5,000 grant. It's a healthy grant. In fact, if people wanted to just get $5,000 from us in the beginning, we ran a grant program from 97 to 2003, gave away $3 million to about 120 projects, some of which were whole degree programs, but some of which were things like a grammar gym online or an information literacy gym online. Supplements to undergraduate courses. There were many things that people bought off and tried to chew and then come up with some description of what they had done when they finished. But we asked them to look at large-scale introductory courses first. Then we said, do you have large-scale upper-level courses where you are not doing a good job, you think? And you know that you need to do some things because these folks said we had to do it. And so that was the second round of grants. This is the leadership piece. The grassroots piece is the invention piece. The third thing we said was modular arrangements of information that can be used in lots of different ways, aka the grammar gym or the literacy gym. And then finally we said whole programs that you want to deliver at a distance. I actually don't like the notion when you call it online learning or distance learning or e-learning. I think it's just learning, and that's what these folks said. It's just learning. And so we tried to develop chunks as the leadership message, and then we said, we will give you support for this. If you need to think about it, you can get $5,000 to think about it. If you need to implement it, you can get the amount of money you need to implement it, to actually develop it and implement it. And that is crucial because people have to have time to do the work, and they can't do it if they're teaching 2,000 people in another mode.
Okay. Can I just ask a quick question on that, on where does that investment funding come from? I don't mean from the legislature or from students. I mean, I assume if you're going to do that, you're not going to do something else. So what was the trade-off for that money?
Well, it's called priming the pump. Initially, the institution gave us $400,000 a year to give out in grants.
$400,000 is a percentage of the total budget. What is that, 1%, 2%?
Oh, it's way down there. I mean, we're over a $1 billion budget.
Okay.
I mean, it's way down there. The point was, and I should make this other point, one of the things that the community was asking all of us as research universities to do was to do better by undergraduate teaching. The noise level had gotten so high in the 90s about the way that we were approaching our undergraduates that we really needed to be rethinking undergraduate education. So we heard that, and we started investing in it. So it was an institutional investment. I personally think, for example, I'm sorry Peter Blake has left, but I have been arguing about this. I think the state ought to step up to this too. If the state wants to turn this corner and help people know and be able to do what they need to know and be able to do across disciplines, then there needs to be help for people to rethink that process. And because you have to run two operations at the same time. You're running the old one and you're building the new one. And it takes a little bit of money to do that.
So,
I was going to say that to make some of these reforms happen, it takes a multi-pronged approach. Certainly you need leadership up at the top, sort of setting the vision, setting the stage. Why do we need to do this? What sorts of things do we need to do? But then you need the people to actually do that, the faculty. And so it's going to take release time for them, probably faculty development, maybe even some convincing. I like to
talk about the convincing part, if you would.
Well, I like to tell people about how students are changing. And warn them that, you know, what's going to happen if all of our students start coming to us and want to matriculate as juniors because they've taken all of these other courses online. There has to be some value added to going to a brick and mortar institution,
mm-hmm.
and that value are the people. That value is the people that's there. Students are certainly different than they've ever been before. They spend 7.5 hours a day in front of a screen with 11 hours worth of content packed in that time because they're multitasking. A text every 12 minutes is the average for a teenager right now. I mean, it's a different world for us, and we need to adjust to that.
You're evangelizing. I want you to think about, if you were running the show, what would you do? I know it's a multi-pronged approach, but what specifically and tactically would you do if you were running the show?
I would have some evangelists. find some. Actually, there's been research that shows that word of mouth from a trusted colleague is probably the best way to spread these innovations in education. So I would support the champions that are already here. I would provide data for them and information for them and provide a forum for them to talk to their peers and work with their peers. Give them release time, have them work in teams so that it's not an individual that's working on redesigning these courses.
Let me just stop. You're going to have a team redesign my course?
You would be on that team, and I'm assuming if you are the only person teaching that course, then that's a different game. And I was thinking of the larger courses where you'd have a whole batch of folks.
Okay.
And then certainly support from the top is really important. This has to be valued as a scholarly task, and so when promotion and tenure time comes up, that's something that needs to be considered. I remember when one of our chancellors came in, the very first thing she did was send back a bunch of tenure and promotion packets. She wasn't rejecting them. What she said was, there's not enough information here to judge whether this person is fulfilling their teaching duties or not. That got everyone's attention. And you can be sure that those were reworked, and then from then on, they paid attention to that. And so that sort of thing, in addition to providing monetary support for things like the release time and technology support that might be needed, and new furniture, or whatever it is that you happen to be doing. But it's multiple areas, multiple directions.
Just guess, what percentage of courses at your institution do you think are trying to do this stuff? I'm being vague intentionally.
Well, let me be vague intentionally, too. It's actually very small at NC State. Scale-up's been adopted at 150 or 175 institutions around the world.
Yes.
But at NC State, it's fairly small. We're teaching a couple of different, probably three different physics courses. Well, no, four different physics courses this way. Two different chemistry courses this way. 11 geographical information system courses this way. Two biology courses. But it is expanding. I put out an RFP talking about some grants. I have some foundation funding to create one of these classrooms somewhere on campus, and so each of our six or seven colleges is putting in a proposal for that. And there's been a lot of interest. So it is growing fairly rapidly, actually. But in terms of our total number of courses, it's pretty small right now.
Okay. I just want to say to both Mark and Kevin that you are now granted total immunity from anything that you say about being held responsible for it in terms of your recommendation to this institution. It's easy for these guys to talk about what they should do at their various institutions, but this is your institution. So you have total immunity. You can say whatever you want. It will not be held against you.
Can I have that in writing?
Yeah.
I do want to follow up with your question in terms of if I were in charge, and not necessarily if I were in charge, but if I could speak to the person who were in charge.
That's okay. You can fantasize.
And I think it's an approach. I think, and because most of my work is in informal learning and works with students before they get to Mason, what I've seen is that there needs to be a grassroots approach. And so we go into communities in the District of Columbia and Northern Virginia and Maryland, and it's one thing to sell the dream of higher ed, but it's another thing to help people understand what it actually requires. And we experienced this in our program. When we got funding from the National Science Foundation, we got this big grant, and we went in and we were doing great work in the first 6 months. We were teaching students how to build video games, and they were becoming engaged and excited about STEM content. And I went in one day on a Saturday, and I asked how many students wanted to go to college. And everybody raised their hand. And then I said, how many of you are seniors? And then probably about two-thirds raised their hand. And this was in November. And I said, how many of you have taken the SAT? Two people's hands went up. I immediately called my program officer at NSF and said, I need to change my grant. I need to pull a portion of that money to focus on STEM pathways. It's one thing to get everybody excited about game design, but it's another thing to get them educated about what it takes to get there. And so we were fortunate enough to be able to spend or to allocate a portion of that grant to focus on STEM pathways. And when I say pathways, I mean it then required that I went over to Vojino and talked with someone there, because a lot of the students in my program were applying and they were getting rejected. And so their parents were upset with me. And so then I had to, as George Mason, explain why their child was not getting into the university. And what I found is that they had a 3-point-something GPA, they had decent SAT scores, but the last math they took was Algebra 1. Or the last science course they took, you know, wasn't appropriate. And nobody ever told them that when your child goes into eighth grade, it matters what math they take. And last week, I got an email from a parent saying, my child has to decide between consumer math and Algebra 2. Which should they take? Wow. Exactly, right? Wow. This is a student who is very adept at computer programming. But with the high stakes testing environment, sometimes the focus is on getting a high GPA versus the challenge. So this whole notion of being community-based and community-focused, I think, is helpful. But then it has to expand into administration and faculty. So me being able to walk over to Vojino and ask them, okay, what's the issue and how can I help prepare my students, mm-hmm. is very helpful. Also, and lastly, cross-disciplinary collaboration. Yes. We say it, we're encouraged to do it, but in some instances, it's not easy. And when you get a grant and you try to put all these people on it, the first question is, okay, where's the money going? Is it going to your college or your college or your college? And then that causes some issue. So I think
So what are you going to do about that?
Well, I think Mason is actually very good about being able to work through some of those issues. I actually collaborate with faculty here at Mason as well as across the country. Through the center, I think that's a vehicle, and helping faculty understand how to collaborate across disciplinary lines. And I think that is where the key is, and also helping us to understand that we need to collaborate outside of our institutions and not just focus so much on, well, I need to do what I need to do here. Part of what we do, we just got a new grant called STEM for All, and it's funded by the National Science Foundation, but it's me and a colleague at Arizona State. And we have assembled a team of people from across the country to deal with this issue of broadening participation in STEM. Because it's not just me in a lab or me in a library trying to figure it out.
Let's hear from, go ahead.
I can offer a very practical solution in our case. Someone asked yesterday about that cadre of adjunct faculty. How can we ask them to do more? Their non-tenure track positions, whether it's an instructor, whether it is a lecturer or an adjunct faculty. Instead of looking at it, how can we ask them to do more, look at it in the opposite way, which is what they did with me. I'm a contract player, and I've been there for 35 years. They asked me, what can we collaborate together to make this situation better? So instead of saying, here's what you need to do more, and in a very, you know, altruistic way, you know, please, we don't want to overburden you. It's more a case of bringing me in and bringing those players into the environment. And so we collaborated together, and we are cheap labor. And if you have that kind of cheap labor, pay them summer money. That's how I was paid. Right. To develop these course materials, I headed the writing team for all 7 courses. And the biggest part of that was summer money. Now, granted, I had to get some course release time during the year to finish things up because I was the head of the team. But that summer money, it's a percentage of my salary. And, it's not
but
a high salary.
I'm going to push you here because all talking in terms of budget. I'm thinking in terms of politics. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Sure. Okay. Let me ask you a question.
Are all math courses gone through to taught the way you're teaching in your school?
Excuse me.
Are all math courses taught at your school this way?
No.
Why not?
Oh, the reason we have so many. We have 3 full calculus sequences for business majors, for life sciences, and for the physical sciences and math majors. And only one of our courses, the linear algebra course, is a math emporium course, is taken in the physical sciences because that's what our math majors take. They're not as high enrollment. And the highest enrollment courses are the calculus sequences, the service courses that we teach. And we don't have the space anymore to offer it much bigger.
But that's not, you've got to think bigger than this. Why don't you have the space? If this is so great and this is so efficient, why didn't the head of your university says, this is the way we're teaching math, and in 5 years, all math courses will be taught there? Why didn't he or she say that?
15 years ago, maybe they did. but I think there are so many other options for using technology. And to be honest, when I first started embracing technology in my own classrooms, I was teaching the engineers and the physical sciences, mathematics for math majors. And there are so many other ways to embrace technology in addition to what we do at the Math Emporium that also have student-centered learning. They're more lab-oriented in a lot of the, for the physical sciences, there's an interplay talking about cooperation with other departments and that sort of thing. We are beginning to do that with biology. That this isn't the only option for using technology. And I wouldn't say the student-centered part of it is what's the most important. And so we do try to incorporate the Math Emporium concept where the on-demand help into our other classes and the type of tutoring that we do and the type of work that we do.
So I just want to...
Sure.
Is it the answer to my question, they're not using it because it's not appropriate, or is they're not using it because there's resistance and there's reasons for the resistance that don't have to do with students?
Mm-hmm. Are they not?
It's a simple question. Is it that it's not appropriate? Because
well,
then we can just go on.
The difficult part of that question is it's not appropriate. Do you mean the online approach to the course materials, or do you mean the full scope of the Emporia model where there's on-demand help and the student learning?
Full scope.
The full scope? Why is it not? That's a very good question.
Think about it and let me.
No, there are more ways to incorporate technology, and other ways to do it. And we only the question is limited space. The question is limited space to provide this on-demand 24/7, 60 hours a week help in this facility, and we have 5,000 students that actually do that now in the courses that are not that structure.
Okay.
So some of it is restricted space.
If you reduce the cost from $91 to $21, and the head of your university, if your problem is lack of resources, the head of your university can't see the difference between 91 and 21 and see where you can pay for the extra resources, then he's not very good at math. But anyway,
that was 15 years ago, and that was one particular.
Let's go on.
Course.
It could just be a humanist, but the as am I. But I think you're quite right to raise this as a political problem, because it often looks like an economics problem, but I think it really is a political problem, and that centers in a few different locations. We work with about 150 colleges and universities, so we see these patterns play out again and again. And one of them is the question of faculty socialization. Again and again, faculty are rewarded for being professional scholars in their fields, of which this has no connection at all, which is a huge obstacle. And even when they are teachers, they've often been trained in teaching in a great fashion that was cutting edge circa, 1850, right? I mean, you know, the sage on the stage, or even the seminar classroom without technology. I mean, these are modes that have been placed in. We can shift domain from politics to sociology and psychology and say this is where the faculty members are professionally rewarded, this is where they are psychologically rewarded, this is where they've won the game, if we accept the gaming metaphor. Right. Now, given that, tenured faculty are a shrinking minority of faculty in the United States. This has been so for a long time, and I don't see any countervailing trends against it.
Right.
But these are the ones who have faculty governance.
So let me ask you a question, then. Would it be your advice that, look, don't mess with the tenured faculty that don't want to do this. Just let them do what they're doing, okay? And focus on the new people coming in and contract teachers or all sorts of other teachers. And because it's, you know, there's only so many fights you can pick. That's what you would do. Is that what you're saying?
That's what many institutions are doing now. And I think of this as the long-term or Soviet model of change. Unfortunately, this recession, or whatever we call our economic time, has mitigated against it in part because employment for people in their 20s and 30s has gone down, whereas, as we've seen across almost all industries, employment for people in their 60s on up is remaining or increasing. This past jobs report that we just had yesterday, I mean, something like 68% of the jobs in that went to people 60 and older. So
you got a problem with that?
Boy, do I.
Okay.
But it's an interesting issue where we're beginning to track generational tensions beginning to occur.
Yeah.
But I think that's one reason why I joke about this, the Soviet model. It's actually not that much of a joke. You wait for the demographics to push the change. But take a step back to politics. Again, you're quite right to mention this. We don't have a single stable political model for this kind of transformation. The reason is, if you listen to what all these panelists have just said, think about the model of the university they sketched out. You described counseling failures that were crucial, as well as faculty. You're describing faculty. You guys are describing administrators. You're talking about a total model of university transformation. We didn't mention communications faculty or communication staff. We didn't mention admissions or alumni staff who play another key role in this. But that's the kind of political wave that needs to sweep over. One of the major obstacles, I don't know if this would apply at GMU, you can tell me. We found at schools that have roughly 200 to 300 faculty that a provost or dean position can single-handedly block all this transformation from happening.
Would never happen here.
So I would like to say, though,
or some other hypothetical institution, right?
It isn't about old or young either, because we have plenty of people who have been around Virginia Tech for a very long time who jumped into the breach on this. One of the most exciting things I saw when they started building this process were 12 people sitting around a table of all ranks, all shape, colors, and sizes. They drank the Kool-Aid and decided they were going to stay in the room until they finished. And they did a wonderful job. Now, part of the thing that Terry can't tell you about, which goes to your political question, is they all did such a good job that they got jobs in other places.
Can I just ask you and Terry this question, and then I want to ask Mark something. Sure. If you had to identify the level at which you most wanted an enthusiastic person, level at the university, is it the president? Is it the provost? Is it the department chairman? Basically, I'll give you those three levels.
Good question.
To drive this, which is the most important level at which to have an enthusiast?
From my point of view, it's department head, absolutely, without a doubt. We had a very enthusiastic department head, because that is the go-between from the higher levels of administration and to the faculty. And he was so enthusiastic and so supportive that I think that was how we got tenured faculty, young tenure track faculty, and non-tenure track faculty to work together, as Ann said, in these teams to provide something new and different. And you gave me a little time to reflect on the other, so I will say that very quickly. The obvious answer, and I don't know why it didn't come to me right away, one size doesn't fit all. And that's what we're talking about with a comprehensive mathematics learning center. Gee, I should have had those words at the top of my head. But there are variations, and we choose to use those variations in different ways.
Mm-hmm. So behind her department chair, though, and I said, we've had thousands of groups to come through the math emporium.
You are all welcome.
To figure out how they would do their own version of what would work. The dean needs to stand behind the department chair so that if she is out on a limb and it gets sawed off, they figure out how to get to another limb. The provost has to say...
I understand they're all important. I just want to know which one do you...
Well, but they have to be behind them. They cannot be wiggling behind them.
Mark. Now, I bet you don't have many people in the English department coming and saying, how can I do what you're doing?
Well, I was going to say, I don't think it's any of the levels that you named. Enthusiasm is for faculty who are in the classroom teaching, you know, three, four, whatever, how many classes. Enthusiasm is not what gets them there. It's seeing other people have success or productive failures do it. And I think the most important people are people who are in the trenches doing it. And I think, institutionalized means for them to share their work, and you mentioned evangelism. That's something that you can't force people to do. But personally, I try to make everything as open as possible. All my classes are online, my assignments are online, I put my course evaluations online for just anybody to see. I think it's part of being a public employee. I want the public to know what I'm doing, and I want to share with them. But I wouldn't force that upon other people. That might make some of my colleagues flinch.
So let's hear some reactions from you. And why don't you raise your hand, and the people with the microphones will come and find you. It can be questions, but they can also be comments.
Quickly, though, we've had about 10,000 questions pop up on Twitter over the course of.
Okay.
I just want to kind of just give a brief overview of all the comments that we've seen and a bunch of questions, and realize we won't have time for all of them. People were very interested in the scale-up model first, and I think some of the people in the audience wanted to note that Mason will have a room designed for scale-up, and there's an RFP out currently for any faculty member to put in proposals for that. Also very excited about and interested in flipped classes, and people would love to hear specific examples of how to do that in their disciplines. Kevin, people really were interested in the idea of students creating media, and so might want to hear more about that. The application of technology to all fields, and I think that cuts across many of what the speakers were saying. Mark, people were fascinated by the social and leaning forward pedagogy, and so might want to hear just a little bit more about how you use that in your classes. The different kinds of MOOCs, there were tons of questions that popped up. First of all, people were glad to finally hear about distinctions between MOOCs. But then there were questions about logistics, the plagiarism problem, attrition, how to confirm enrollment. And also, people were glad to hear about arts and the humanities. And finally, the issue of $400,000 being devoted to an initiative and how that may work for some institutions and not others. And so maybe talking about the logistics of that.
Okay. Who's ever got microphones out there? Let's start.
I'd like to pick up on two points, the scale-up classrooms and the math emporium. Teaching by walking around. We, at my former institution, Clemson University, adopted the scale-up model in a number of classes and disciplines. What I'd like to do is ask about extending teaching by walking around into the virtual world where we help faculty take a course online. Do you have any suggestions on how we can incorporate that kind of contact through technology in this virtual world where we're teaching more and more of our classes?
Help me out. You're talking about teaching students or teaching teachers?
Our group in instructional design here helps faculty develop their online version of their course.
Yes.
And what I'm asking is, are there ways that these panelists might suggest that this teaching by walking around model can be utilized in that framework where the instructor is in a virtual setting?
Anyone want, Bryan?
Yeah, if I can take two currently existing answers to that. One is to make extensive use or as much use as possible of automation. So you think, do you know the Carnegie Mellon OLI? Which if you haven't seen these are pretty tremendous. The Open Learning Initiative objects. These are basically science modules online that were developed. These are quite extraordinary. Developed in a collaboration between learning technologists, psychologists, educators to produce these wonderful environments into which a student can go, and they are probably the best online teaching that's automated that's out there. I mention this because that quick feedback is something which instructors can provide, but using automation to help is a great way of, well, being sane, among other things. The second is strongly emphasizing that we live in the age of social media. Now, that is a cliche to emphasize just about everywhere except for higher education, because we have not embraced social media as much as many ways we could have or should have. For example, the most widely used in university-supported technology in higher education is the course management system, or LMS. Its most widespread use is for sharing e-reserved documents. Its discussion board is one of the least used across the United States, across all sectors of education. In many ways, that's a kind of anti or asocial tool. Meanwhile, social media is all about that kind of connectivity. So I think embracing pedagogies like Mark Sample's social pedagogy, and you'll see on Twitter, some other people have mentioned other examples of this, is a great way to have that virtual walking around to find a student and see what they're doing. The CMOOCs or ERMOOCs that I mentioned are also really good examples of that.
Other questions?
At Mason, a number of our schools are credited by outside organizations which tend to impose a stricture or standard that enforces the traditional professional scholar mode for measuring quality and doesn't particularly reward and encourage innovation. How do we deal with them? How do we bring them somehow into this conversation?
The only one that I know about is ABET. The Accrediting Board for Engineering Technologies. And when I was putting together the sort of the very, very coarse-grained performance outcomes for a two-semester physics sequence, what I did was take their list of things, skills that they wanted students to have, and map things to that. And so if you remember the first screen that I showed that was that listed things that employers want students to have, that's what they were listing. Now, maybe other areas or other accrediting agencies don't have those, but it was very easy to fit into ABET. In any case, the thing to remember is that it's not a zero-sum game. You don't have to give up covering content in order to encourage students to practice communication skills or critical thinking. You can't teach problem solving without having problems to solve in a content area. So they end up, you end up not only getting better content skills, they also at the same time pick up and practice these other 21st century skills. So I don't see it as a conflict at all. In fact, I see that as a big opportunity because they have such a big hammer.
Well, and also the accrediting associations are not a closed system. It sounds like it sometimes, but we're the people who inform how we are reviewed and who does the reviewing and what the accrediting association should be looking for. So I remember thinking when the all the accrediting bodies started looking at us and saying, you need to be more responsible for, about demonstrating your learning outcomes. I thought, hooray, finally these conversations have surfaced from our colleagues. When they sit in these review meetings and symposia that the accrediting associations pull together for us to find out what we should be looking at to be high quality, excellent institutions, finally we are saying that we need to look at that. So it is we, you know, we get to say this. We get to, and we get to continue to talk to these people about this.
Yes, over here. Well, we're not hearing from you.
One comment and one question. Comment is to the question about how to do it online using Blackboard has, in addition to discussion board, has something called collaborate, when you can actually divide the students in the room of table groups like you do in Scala and work with them in the group. We are actually trying this as a pilot model last summer in physics course. The second is question to lady from Math Emporium. Is my understanding that physical sciences math courses were not specially interested in using Emporium, and do you know the reasons for that? Because gossip I heard, and let me be open about it, that they consider it was not high enough quality for students who go into physical sciences and engineering to use this method. That's a gossip I never...
Sure. No, I understand the question completely. Let me tell you a little bit about the history. The first course that we had there and continue to have is the linear algebra for the physical sciences. It is the highest enrolled course we have now. There's 2,000 students in the fall semester in that class. So we do use it for the courses in the physical sciences. Also, when we first opened, and this refers to that space situation, when we first opened, and for one semester we had 250 computers, and now we're up to 537. Very, very quickly we opened to a large amount of space. But it was actually my job initially, before we expanded our course offerings from one commercial software and our handwritten stuff for the linear algebra course, was to bring the physical sciences courses over to the Math Emporium on sort of a mini scale-up classroom in a lot of ways. And we used the presentation. I piloted a course where we used the presentation area to introduce Mathematica labs and then have the students go out in groups. The physical space around computer pods like you see there, and rolling chairs, very important part of everything, and we still use in the Emporium model too of our courses, that we had a space and we thought was very, very useful, and it still is. We still have people come over and do labs outside of our standard staffing times. Our standard staffing times, for space reasons, we have 5,000 students that need to come there and get help. They do not have a lecture classroom. Our physical sciences classes do still have a traditional lecture classroom, some with recitation classes, so they have that smaller environment with their classroom teacher. So we don't have as much space and available for those students so that we can provide the maximum amount of space and contact time with the students that don't have another alternative for that contact. And so that is part of it. We do absolutely use the Math Emporium for our physical sciences students. It's just that we use them in a different way.
But I also want to tell you what we're getting ready to do next with biology.
Right. This is very important.
This is the interdisciplinary piece that is much harder to do. These folks have said from the beginning, people might remember math better when they get ready to apply it if, as they're learning it, they were getting applications in their area of study. And so we are beginning to launch a program now in biology. And they are redesigning the two introductory biology courses where we actually apply the math in biological concepts. So the two faculties are going to work together on pulling that together. That's not a space issue. Mm-mm. That's a structural issue.
Mm. Over here.
Hi, my question, I guess, is for Mark, but everyone else. We've all heard horror stories about pictures on Facebook and things coming back to haunt students. Do any of you, I guess, see a way that social media for students can translate to the workplace, how they can use those technologies to show the skills they've learned on campus?
Actually, it sounded like Bryan had a...
That'd be a great question for, I think, 2004, because it's already happened. Businesses, we already have blogging and podcasting from CEOs for private administration. We have a huge industry of social media applications rolled out within industries. I mean, that's already there. And in fact, we have social media policies for so many businesses about what does it mean to tweet when you have a job like this, or what does it mean to be on Facebook for a job
like
this.
I'm not sure that was the question. I think he was
wondering
about...
I'm setting the context to get to this, because that's an important point. For students, in many ways, they're outside of school practice of being on whatever it is they're using, if they're using blogging or if they're using Facebook, is already preparing them for that. I mean, one of the roles of the university is to help them thinking about that reflectively, because they have no other source for that. They're not going to get that training in K through 12 to think critically about social media. They're not going to get it at work, because work is busy with other things. This is the spot where they can get that. Now, is there a downside to this? Can an employer not hire a student because they see a picture of the student doing something they wish they'd gone to their grave without ever having seen? Yes, that's possible. And in many ways, students are already learning how to do this. You've got Lee Rainey's book here. The Pew Internet and American Life Project did a great survey of teenagers and found they were more likely than adults to take care of privacy online, which is a counterintuitive finding until you look at it hard and realize that adults don't get told, don't do this, over and over again. K through 12 students do. So I think this is already happening, and the job for the university is to do our ancient function, our centuries-old function, of teaching students to think critically about this environment within which they swim.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mark.
I think students are a lot more aware. I hate the term digital natives, because many of them are not digitally fluent, but I've had quite a few students say when I'm using blogs or social media in the classroom, you know, specifically, they want to know if they can do it anonymously or at least use a fake name. And sometimes it's because, you know, we're in Northern Virginia and their employer is some sort of agency that doesn't want them on social media in the first place. But, you know, I think there are ways that's kind of, I at least build it into my classes now.
One quick point. Yep. In the College of Education, we actually have students create portfolios, and that exercise is a way to help students pull together the artifacts of what they've learned through the course of their academic career and present it in a way that makes sense and that tells their story. And so I think the use of portfolios in addition to social media is a way that students are finding that they could effectively communicate with potential employers.
Do you have a campus-wide digital portfolio strategy here at George Mason?
We have a college-wide.
Right.
I'm not sure about what the campus is doing.
Well, then you think about it.
Yeah.
This makes me...
Let's get some other questions here.
Hi, thanks for a great panel. I've really learned a lot. I really appreciate it. First, a comment on the Math Emporium thing, which you went through really quickly, but I think is really important. You're really intentional about how you train the staff.
Absolutely.
I forget how you call what you call the staff, but
we call them instructional assistants, but they are, students call them tutors.
Right. So. You're really explicit about your training and how carefully you train those folks, and I think that's hugely important.
We have a two-day, we pay the undergraduates to come, and the grad students are already on campus, so it's the week before classes start, and it's two solid days of very intense training, role play activities. We, like, this is the wrong way, right way, this looks good, but it doesn't really work kind of thing, a lot of discussion.
Yeah, that's excellent. I have a question for Ann Moore, stimulated in part by the closing panel yesterday, which is about fostering change in public higher education. You said you've had thousands of people come through to look at Math Emporium. and this is familiar to me because I think of Alverno College as probably the most studied and least emulated educational innovation. What do you know about what has happened after those people have come to visit and learn about what you're doing?
I don't have data. I have anecdotal evidence. I know that the former department chair went to another state, another university, and started a huge math emporium there. Another one of the implementers of the emporium went across the country and did a math emporium there. There are three institutions in Virginia right now that are instituting math emporia, probably for the wrong reasons. Somebody told them to do it. And they need to get this imagination going. These guys are absolutely right. The important piece is the intellectual imagination that's going to be doing that, not somebody telling you to do it. So you have to do both. So I know three of them are being built here now. They are all over the place, and they are not 500-seat emporia. Some of them are 25 seats. Some of them are collecting points where you bring your own laptop, and this is where you get to get some help. There are many variations on it, but I have no idea what the numbers are because people have gone and invented their own version of it. The other point I would want to make is that, Terry already said it, there is no one-size-fits-all with this particular model. We have a scale-up classroom, too, and we're building another one. We are trying portfolios across the curriculum. We're trying everything, and we're trying to do it in a, this is the message from the front, this is what we need to be doing as an institution, and then seeing where it arises, because some of these things are going to fail. And you don't want the whole thing to go down because you built it all under one tent and said, this tent has to stay up. Some of the things are going to fail. We are going to learn from the failures. What I loved about these folks at the beginning was the things that didn't work, they told everybody, don't do this. It doesn't work. We failed miserably on this piece. This does work. Try it out.
Bob, let me ask you the same question that was asked about people coming through, and then you probably had a lot of visitors.
Right.
And
right. But when people ask if they can come and sit in on my class, I tell them no. No sitting allowed. You have to roam around and listen in and ask questions and find out what's going on. And so we have a lot of people doing that. The scale-up website that I mentioned earlier, it's a public website, but there's also, you can get a password that gives you access to a couple of dozen research papers, plus instructional materials, how to design groups. We have TA training materials as well, including videos of they're staged, but it's groups that are functioning well and groups that aren't functioning well, and things like that. So a lot of people access those.
Is it sweeping the country?
Well, there's that MIT teaches all of their physics intro physics classes this way. Clemson does all of their intro math this way. It's at it's around 150 to 175 places that I know of, but there's probably at least twice that, because mm-hmm. usually when I go to something like this, somebody will come up to me and say, hey, we should send you some pictures. We've been doing this a while.
As an institution, we don't keep data like that.
No, that's what I understand. I'm just, let me ask you something. Can you teach Shakespeare tragedies that way?
Yes. In fact, I use Shakespeare as an explanation to my students, because you have to convince the students, you know, this is a good idea, because they're used to things being handed to them. And I tell them that, you know, if this was high school, in fact, they may have been in a high school class in Shakespeare where the students took turns standing up and reading some portion of the play in class to everybody else. We don't have time for that. You read the play at home, and then you come to class, and we're going to spend some time talking about all the interesting questions it raises and the difficult things. It's the same thing with my physics class. I give them assignments that are due, readings that are due, places to go on the web and watch videos or whatever, and there's homework that's due on those before they come to class. In fact, one thing that I do that's fun because it happens every semester, I've got very, very detailed performance outcomes that I'd mentioned for every section of the book. If, you know, in chapter 22, section 3, these are the four things you need to be able to do. And so what I will do is I'll tell the students you're responsible for all these, and then when the first test comes up, I will specifically pick out things that we didn't cover in class, because I tell them you're responsible for them. If you have questions, ask. I will specifically pick out performance outcomes we did not discuss in class, put them on the test, and what's fun is that every time some student will come in, raise their hand and say, you know, we didn't talk about such and such and it was on the test. And my response is, well, why not? Why didn't we talk about that? If you had a question on it. And they learn very rapidly. Oh,
I got to tell you, I'm having trouble understanding what the four performance outcomes would be in reading the first half of Hamlet.
What do you want? Why do you have students read Hamlet?
I don't know. I'm not an English teacher, I'm just thinking. Mark helped me out here, but I don't know. You know,
But there must be some reason to read Hamlet.
Well, there is, but I'm not sure that...
That's what you do. As you look at those, what do you want students to be able to do? Not understand. Nobody knows what that means. Well, basically, what I tell... Because this is a hard question.
I mean, you don't do anything. You understand. That's the problem.
Well,
appreciate, understand.
You're talking to a student, and you say, wow, this guy really's got a solid grasp of the first whatever it is of Hamlet. What would they be doing that would give you that hint? That's what you put on your performance outcomes. They're able to compare Hamlet to other plays. They're able to compare the characters in Hamlet to each other. They're able to whatever. I don't know. I'm not an English person either. But it's very, very specific. And students love those because they think you're telling them what's on the test.
Right.
And in some sense you are. But why should it be a game? Why should they try to guess what it is that's important about a class? Tell them. There's a whole bunch of these. You're probably not going to be able to get all of them. The more you do, the better your grade's going to be. It's as simple as that.
Would you acknowledge that it's a little harder to do that with the Shakespeare than with physics?
I don't know. I've never done it with Shakespeare. I don't know. Can't answer that.
Question. We have any more? Yes.
Hi.
You were on.
Okay. Hi. My name is Suzanne Dove, and I'm visiting here from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, another public university that's also having similar conversations around educational innovation. And Professor Pearlstein, I really liked your question about how to actually carry out a pretty significant cultural change of the nature that we're talking about here in the last 2 days. My job is at the Wisconsin School of Business, so I'm in the business school on our campus, and I work for our dean, who's a very visionary person. And we've talked a lot about how to actually implement this change, and it's not easy. But I just thought that I could share one or two things that we've talked about that has seemed to be producing results in our space, and it might be relevant for others in this room. So our dean, early on, took a cue from Philip Kotter's 8 Steps of Leading Change, and the first step is the one that I think is most often ignored, and that is create a sense of urgency around the need for change. And so I think that the panels, especially some of the panels we heard yesterday and some of the things that you all are talking about today in terms of diminishing public investment.
Yeah, I was about to say in Wisconsin, there's a two-word answer to that, Scott Walker.
Yes, exactly. So the diminishing public support for state universities, the changing ways that our students are wanting to learn and wanting to engage with the material, the questions that people are asking all around us about what is the value of this degree? What am I getting from being a Badger, from being a Wisconsin graduate? So those are, creating that sense of urgency has actually really helped. And our dean held a number of faculty staff meetings when he first started in his tenure, and he really scared people. You could see people leaving and going, oh my gosh, things are really about to change. And he went so far as to share actual numbers that showed why we would no longer be able to support the high salaries that business faculty command if we continue to operate the way that we are operating. So I wanted to just congratulate President Cabrera for having this forum, because I think this is a really good way to start.
Okay. And I think the panel would say, you've got to come up, step two is to make people understand that this is as much an opportunity as anything else, that it's not a negative thing, it's not a lose-lose situation or anything like that, because if that's what the attitude people bring to it, it's not going to work out too well. But. Do we have other questions? And anything more from Josh from Tweet World?
We do have one question, Mr. Moderator.
Okay. Josh, we'll go afterwards.
I have a question for Ann and Terry or anyone else who's familiar with Carol Twigg's work. The National Center for Academic Transformation for years has been adding value in the transformation and redesign of courses, but has been frustrated at the inability to get those good ideas taken up more broadly in the institutions. But in recent years, Carol has been focusing on redesign alliances within institutions and across institutions. I wonder, if, as participating institutions in that, whether you have anything to offer on that score.
Truth in advertising, I have been on her advisory board from the beginning. And this story might illustrate what the problem is, but we've said it in many different ways already today. She started a grant process. We are all very familiar with getting grants and implementing them and doing good stuff with them. And it works in our institutions like a one-off. They got a grant, they're going to do it, and we're going to keep on doing what we're doing. So 10 years later, we were having the Redesign Alliance conferences, and lots of people who were doing incredibly good work were coming to the conferences and really enjoying each other, comparing notes, getting ideas for the next thing they were going to do. But they were also saying, why don't I get this kind of support in my institution? And I went back to the advisory board meeting, and I said, we're running a counseling center now. It's therapy sessions for people who are getting no support for what they're doing at home. So Carol immediately launched into trying to find a way to help people understand the leadership trench in which they resided and what their correspondence was to this particular leadership trench that she has now hundreds of demonstration projects, lots of data. She has the data on where the emporiums are that have been funded by her, but there have been many more beyond that. The demonstrations are out there, and now they are shutting down the demonstration projects and trying to consult with people to help them understand what they have to do structurally to make these things go. I don't know the answer to that piece of it, and neither does she. We have to figure that out, because it is a structural shift in our institutions, as I believe someone said earlier today. And so we're all trying to do this together. It makes everybody a learner. And I don't know what learning looks like for your new president. I don't. He seems eager to embrace it, but I don't know what that's going to look like here. Now, Terry goes to the redesign conferences and speaks with colleagues who are in her particular trench. maybe you have things to...
I guess what strikes me about the new trends in the National Center for Academic Transformation, which has done just wonderful work to get the word out and to provide the support. I know the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation funded a huge project for community colleges to establish the Emporia model and to use it in the way that fits them the best. Because we were the first, I would say we have an even different issue going on here, is that when you start these projects now, you really need to be thinking towards sustainability and continuous improvement. And that's where more of our stumbling block is now. We've done it, and it's been successful, and it's been a wonderful experience. But we wrote our own materials. We need to improve them. We need to have that ability to do that and to sustain what we do as time goes on and for in all kinds of ways. And so that's another part of this picture that these centers could do, and what you're asking about is collaboration with other universities. This is the kind of place to go to get that collaboration.
If the difference in your cost benefit, it's not a savings, it's a benefit, is 91 and 21, make sure that somewhere along the way you say how much of that is going to turn back into sustaining something as opposed to making it a one-off. We did that. They did that on a grant. They're going to keep on going. Okay. You have to find a way to instantiate it structurally.
Josh, are there any specific questions you're getting rather than just what's trending? But is there any questions that you want to pose to the panel?
Yes. A lot of people, besides why to read Hamlet, a lot of people are talking about the need for Mason faculty across colleges to know what each other is doing and to collaborate more. And so I guess the question would be, how do you do that?
How do you do more
collaboration? How do you go about interacting with faculty in multiple colleges, finding out what each other are working on so that the collaborations can be more effective?
My first wise guy comment, it would be help to have a faculty club to have lunch with each other. That's just a personal point.
Well, I mean, the first answer is really simple, and that is read the communication you get university-wide that talks about what people are doing, as well as the communication you get at the college level. I collaborate with a lot of different faculty, and the way it starts is I'll meet someone in a setting like this, and then I'll say, let's get together for coffee. We don't have a faculty club, but we have Starbucks. And so we go and we sit and we figure out if there's a way to collaborate. And if we do, we take it a step further. If not, You know, my rule is I'll meet with anybody once. If there's, I know, I shouldn't, like, say that, but I will. And I'll talk with faculty. I've collaborated with people in art. I'm now working on a grant with someone in business. So for me, it's really about figuring out ways to further the work that I'm doing and to bring in other people to accentuate it. So you have to sometimes step out and take the time to get to know people and networks. I mean, we talk about social networking. Here's an opportunity to really use social networking to connect with faculty who are on your same campus.
Okay, we have time for one more question, if there is one. Yes, I see a hand up over there.
Hi, Mr. Beichner, is it? If I got that name right, hi. I'm not really the person qualified to do this, but if you ever wanted to learn more about the pedagogical purpose of reading Shakespeare's plays aloud in a classroom, I'd be happy to do it, and I'd be prepared to bet that any number of English professors here, the one I would recommend would be Devin Hodges, but there are others, I'm sure, who can explain to you why it is not useless to read a play which
no,
is meant
no,
to be performed.
No.
He didn't say that.
In his defense, he didn't even come close to suggesting that. I'm the one who said, I'm not sure I could give you, for each act of the play, four things that you wanted the student to come away from that was very distinct.
Well,
before learning outcomes from Act Two of Hamlet. I don't know whether I could, I'm smart enough or creative enough to give that.
Mr. Beichner suggested that reading in a classroom was a K through 12 kind of activity, which could be dismissed by students who had read the play at home and then discussed it in class. But I just want to point out that since it's a play and is meant to be performed aloud, that students who perform it aloud learn something they do not learn by either reading it to themselves or discussing it in a classroom. I'd be happy to listen to him tell me how to teach physics. Thanks.
Understood. No, I agree. What I was talking about was my own memories of high school, where we really just, you know, okay, you read the next half page, all right, you read the next half page, was not performance at all. But I agree with you, and if I implied that I didn't think Hamlet was a good idea, I certainly didn't mean that.
Do you find that both of you, that the sciences are more receptive to thinking about doing things the way you've done them than the humanities, and that the instinct of the humanities department is not for us?
No, not at all. And I'll give you an example from political science. One of the way the tables are structured, there are three teams of three students, and so they're labeled A, B, and C at every table. And so one of the political science teachers tells me that what they do is they pick a current event, you know, the election's coming up or something like that. So let's say the response of the candidates to Sandy. And so they'll have all the A groups go to the web and find out how Fox News covered that. All the B groups go to MSNBC and see how they covered that. And all the B groups go to the BBC and see if they covered that. And then compare what was left out of one, what was presented in another. When they did say the same thing, how did they say it differently? Compare all those. And after you get that done, then pick some other current event of your choice, scour the web, learn as much about it as you can, and then each individual now write the story up as if you are working for one of those media outlets. And once you have the story written, give it to somebody else and see if they can figure out who you're working for. So you can do this in all sorts of areas.
There is a classic two cultures divide, broadly speaking, between the sciences and the humanities and their uptake of technology. And you can see it across a whole group of areas. In scholarly publication, the humanities are way behind in putting scholarly publication online. A lot of humanists aren't sure peer review exists online, whereas in the sciences, we have tons and tons of material. Mm-hmm. In part, this is because the sciences often need digital technology to do their basic work.
Right.
An astronomer is pretty useless without technology in the past, say, 1,000 years. But we also have the fact that many humanists see their work as being primarily about texts and the inherited model of text being primarily analog. The digital humanities movement has begun to change that, bringing in things like text mining, data visualization. But those lags are still pretty much there. And when I mentioned the two different types of MOOCs, I don't think it's coincidental that the most popularly known and the biggest MOOCs are largely in STEM fields.
Well, does it not have something to do with the fact that there are right answers in physics and there are not right answers in humanities?
Yes and no, because the not right answers lead you to the whole field of interpretation, which, as we know, can be done textually at a distance for quite a long period of time. And discussing these, someone mentioned Blackboard's use of video conferencing.
Right.
We can do that all the time right now. I don't think it's a hermeneutic problem at all.
Okay. Thank you all very much. It's been a great panel. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.